Indefensible. Apparently, that is what the American strategists are whispering to each other. That in itself is not serious. What is serious is that Europe is morally, spiritually indefensible. And today, the indictment is brought against it not by the European masses alone, but on a world scale, by tens and tens of millions of men who, from the depth of slavery, set themselves up as judges. The colonialists may kill in Indochina, torture in Madagascar, imprison in Black Africa, crack down in the West Indies. Henceforth, the colonized know that they have an advantage over them. They know that their temporary masters are lying. Therefore, that their masters are weak. And since I have been asked to speak about colonization and civilization, let us go straight to the principal lie that is the source of all the others. Colonization and civilization. First, we must study how colonization works to decivilize the colonizer, to brutalize him in the true sense of the word, to degrade him, to awaken him to buried instincts, to covetousness, violence, race hatred, and moral relativism. And then, one fine day, the bourgeoisie is awakened by a terrific boomerang effect. The Gestapos are busy. The prisons fill up, the torture standing around the wrecks invent, refine, discuss. People are surprised, they become indignant, they say, how strange, but never mind, it's Nazism, it will pass. And they wait, and they hope, and they hide the truth from themselves, that it is barbarism, the supreme barbarism, the crowning barbarism that sums up all the daily barbarisms, that it is Nazism, yes, but that before they were its victims, they were its accomplices, that they tolerated that Nazism before it was inflicted on them, that they absolved it, shut their eyes to it, legitimized it, because until then it had happened, it had been applied only to non-European peoples. That they have cultivated that Nazism, that they are responsible for it, and that before engulfing the whole edifice of Western civilization in its reddened waters, it oozes, seeps, and trickles from every crack. Yes, it would be worthwhile to study the steps taken by Hitler and Hitlerism, and to reveal to the very distinguished, very humanistic, very Christian bourgeois of the 20th century that without being aware of it, he has a Hitler inside him, that Hitler inhabits him, that Hitler is his demon, that if he rails against him, he is being inconsistent, and that at bottom, what he cannot forgive Hitler for is not the crime in itself, the crime against man. It is not the humiliation of man as such. It is the crime against the white man. The humiliation of the white man. And the fact that he applied to Europe colonialist procedures which until then had been reserved exclusively for the Arabs of Algeria, the coolies of India, and the niggers of Africa. And that is the great thing I hold against pseudo-humanism. That for too long it has diminished the rights of man, that its concept of those rights has been and still is narrow and fragmentary, incomplete and biased, and all things considered, sordidly racist. I have talked a good deal about Hitler because he deserves it. He makes it possible to see things on a large scale and to grasp the fact that capitalist society, at its present stage, is incapable of establishing a concept of the rights of all men. just as it has proved incapable of establishing a system of individual ethics, whether one likes it or not. At the end of the blind alley that is Europe, I mean the Europe of Adenauer, Schumann, Bidault, and a few others, there is Hitler. And at the end of capitalism, which is eager to outlive its day, there is Hitler. And at the end of formal humanism and philosophic reconciliation, there is Hitler. And this thing being so, I cannot help thinking of one of his statements. We aspire not to equality, but to domination. The country of a foreign race must become once again a country of serfs, of agricultural laborers, or industrial workers. It is not a question of eliminating the inequalities among men, but of widening them and making them into a law.
Une civilisation qui choisit de fermer les yeux à ses problèmes le plus cruciaux est une civilisation atteinte. Une civilisation qui ruse avec ses principes est une civilisation moribonde. Le fait est que la civilisation dite européenne, la civilisation occidentale, telle que l'ont façonné deux siècles de régime bourgeois, est incapable de résoudre les deux problèmes majeurs auxquels son existence a donné naissance. Le problème du prolétariat et le problème colonial. Que de ferrer à la barre de la conscience et à la barre de la raison. Cette Europe-là est impuissante à se justifier et que de plus en plus elle se réfugie dans une hypocrisie d'autant plus odieuse qu'elle a de moins en moins chance de tromper. L'Europe est indéfendable. Il paraît que c'est la constatation que se confient tout bas les stratagèmes américains. En soi, cela n'est pas grave. Le grave est que l'Europe est moralement, spirituellement indéfendable. Et aujourd'hui, il se trouve que ce ne sont pas seulement les masses européennes qui incriminent, mais que l'acte d'accusation est proféré sur le plan mondial par des dizaines et des dizaines de milliers d'hommes qui, au fond de l'esclavage, s'érigent en juges. On peut tuer en Indochine, torturer à Madagascar, emprisonner en Afrique noire, sévir aux Antilles, les colonisés savent désormais qu'ils ont sur les colonisateurs un avantage. Ils savent que leur maître provisoire mente. Donc, que leurs maîtres sont faibles. Et puisqu'aujourd'hui, il m'est demandé de parler de la colonisation et de la civilisation, allons droit au mensonge principal à partir duquel prolifèrent tous les autres. Colonisation et civilisation. La malédiction la plus commune en cette matière est d'être la dupe de bonne foi d'une hypocrisie collective, habile à mal poser les problèmes pour mieux légitimer les odieuses solutions qu'on leur apporte. Cela revient à dire que l'essentiel est ici de voir clair, de penser clair, entendre dangereusement, de répondre clair à l'innocente question initiale. Qu'est-ce qu'en son principe que la colonisation ? de convenir de ce qu'elle ne point, ni évangélisation, ni entreprise philanthropique, ni volonté de reculer les frontières de l'ignorance, de la maladie, de la tyrannie, ni élargissement de Dieu, ni extension du droit. D'admettre une fois pour toutes sans volonté de broncher aux conséquences que le geste décisif est ici de l'aventurier et du pirate, de l'épicier en grand et de l'armateur, du chercheur d'or et du marchand, de l'appétit et de la force, avec derrière l'ombre portée maléfique d'une forme de civilisation qui, à un moment de son histoire, se constate obligée de façon interne d'étendre à l'échelle mondiale la concurrence de ses économies antagonistes. Poursuivant mon analyse, je trouve que l'hypocrisie et des dates récentes que ni Cortés découvrant Mexico du haut du grand Taocoli, ni Pizarre devant Cusco, ou encore Marco Polo devant Cantabaluc, ne protestent d'être les fourriers d'un ordre supérieur qu'ils tuent, qu'ils pillent, qu'ils ont de casques, de lances, de cupidité, que le baveur sont venus plus tard, que le grand responsable dans ce domaine est le pédantisme chrétien pour avoir dans ce domaine posé les équations malhonnêtes christianisme égale civilisation, paganisme égale sauvagerie, d'où ne pouvait que s'en suivre d'abominables conséquences colonialistes et racistes dont sont victimes les Indiens, les Jaunes, les Nègres.
Monsieur Lumumba, Monsieur Lumumba, Monsieur Lumumba.
My thoughts are for those who have been forgotten. We are the people who have been dispossessed, beaten, mutilated. The people whom the conquerors treated as inferiors, in whose faces they spat. A people of kitchen boys, house boys, laundry boys, in short, a people of boys, of yes, buenas, and anyone who wanted to prove that a man is not necessarily a man could take us as an example. Whatever suffering, whatever humiliation could be known, we have known it. But, comrades, they were not able to dull our taste for life. And we resisted. We didn't have much to fight with, but we fought. We fought for 50 years. And today, we have won. Today, our country is in the hands of its children. This sky, this river, these lands are ours. Ours is the lake and the forest. Ours, Karisimbi, Niriagongo, Nimariyuga, Mikeno, Ehu, mountains sprung from the word of fire. People of the Congo, this is a great day. It is the day when the nations of the world welcome Congo, our mother, and still more, Congo, our child. Child of our sleepless nights, of our sufferings, of our struggles. Comrades and brothers in combat, it is up to us to transform each of our wounds into a nurturing breast, each of our thoughts, our hopes, into a fountain of change. Congo, watch me. I raise him above my head. I put him back on my shoulder. Three times I spit in his face. I set him down on the ground, and I ask you, tell me the truth. Do you know this child? And you all answer, it's Congo, our king. I wish I were a toucan, that wonderful bird, to cross the skies announcing to races
Monsieur
and tongues
Lumumba.
That Congo has been born to us,
Monsieur
our king.
Lumumba.
Long live Congo!
Monsieur Lumumba.
Congo late born,
Monsieur.
May he follow the
Monsieur.
Sparrowhawk.
Monsieur
Congo
Lumumba.
Late born, let him have
Monsieur.
The last word.
Monsieur Lumumba!
Comrades!
Monsieur Lumumba!
Everything remains to be
Monsieur
done
Lumumba.
Or done over.
Ah, Monsieur Lumumba!
But we will
Monsieur.
Do it! We will do it
Monsieur
over
Lumumba.
For Congo!
Monsieur
we will
Lumumba.
Remake all the laws one by one
Monsieur
for
Lumumba.
Congo!
Monsieur.
We will revise
Monsieur.
All
Monsieur.
The customs one by one
Monsieur
for
Lumumba.
Congo!
Monsieur, Monsieur Lumumba.
We will rebuild
Monsieur,
the old
Monsieur,
edifice
Monsieur,
piece by piece from cellar to attic
Monsieur,
for Congo. That which is bowed shall
Monsieur,
be raised
Monsieur,
and that which is raised shall be raised higher for Congo. I demand the union of all. I demand the devotion of every man for Congo. Uhuru, freedom! Congo! These are great days. When this day's rags and this day's tinsel have been burned, let us advance, rejoicing to my anthem, and you step into the new day, into the solstice. Decolonization, which sets out to change the order of the world, is obviously a program of complete disorder. But it cannot come as a result of magical practices, nor of natural shock, nor of a friendly understanding. Decolonization, as we know, is a historical process. That is to say that it cannot be understood, it cannot become intelligible or clear to itself, except in the exact measure that we can discern the movements which give it historical form and content. Decolonization is the meeting of two forces, opposed to each other by their very nature, which in fact owe their originality to that sort of substantification which results from and is nourished by the situation in the colonies. Their first encounter was marked by violence. In their existence together, that is to say, the exploitation of the native by the settler, was carried on by dint of a great array of bayonets and cannon. The settler and the native are old acquaintances. In fact, the settler is right when he speaks of knowing them well. For it is the settler who has brought the native into existence and who perpetuates his existence. The settler owes the fact of his very existence, that is to say his property, to the colonial system. Decolonization never takes place unnoticed, for it influences individuals and modifies them fundamentally. It transforms spectators crushed with their inessentiality into privileged actors, which the grandiose glare of history's floodlights upon them. It brings a natural rhythm into existence, introduced by new men and with a new language and a new humanity. In decolonization, there is therefore the need of a complete calling in question of the colonial situation. If we wish to describe it precisely, we might find it in the well-known words, "The last shall be first, and the first last." Decolonization is the putting into practice of this sentence. That is why, if we try to describe it, all decolonization is successful. The naked truth of decolonization evokes for us in the searing bullets and blood-stained knives which emanate from it. For if the last shall be first, this will only come to pass after a murderous and decisive struggle between the two protagonists. That affirmed intention to place the last at the head of things and to make them climb at a pace, too quickly some say, the well-known steps which characterize an organized society can only triumph if we use all means to turn the scale, including, of course, that of violence.
Rendez-le-moi, mes poupées noires! Qu'elles dissipent l'image des quatre emblèmes marchands d'amour qui s'en vont, viennent sur le boulevard de mon ennui. Rendez-le-moi, mes poupées noires, qu'elles dissipent l'image sempiternelle, l'image hallucinante de fantoches empilées fessues, dont le vent porte au vent la misère, la misère, la misère, miséricorde. Donnez-moi l'illusion que je n'aurai plus à contenter le besoin étal des miséricordes ronflant sous l'inconscience du dindin du monde. Rendez-le-moi, mes poupées noires, que je joue avec elles les jeux naïfs de mon instinct. Rester à l'ombre de ce loi, recouvrer mon courage, mon audace, redevenu moi-même, nouveau moi-même, de ce que hier j'étais, hier, sans complexité, hier, quand est venue l'heure du déracinement. Laisseront-ils jamais cette rancune de mon cœur à l'œil de ma méfiance ouvert trop grand? Ils ont cambriolé l'espace qui était le mien, la coutume, les jours, la vie, la chanson, le rythme, le fort, le sentier, la case, la fumée en fume grise, la sagesse, le mot, la palabre, les vieux, la cadence, 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 les mains, la mesure, les mains, les piétinements, le sol. Rendez-les-moi, mes poupées noires, mes poupées noires, poupées noires, poupées noires. C'est à Ibadan, au Nigeria, que je découvris et ressentis ce qu'on appelle la force d'un peuple. Cette ville, la plus peuplée d'Afrique, s'étend sur une infinité de petites maisons ou cases dont le rassemblement prend son sens à la nuit pleine. Alors, les lumières des échoppes, les musiques, le tumulte et jusqu'aux odeurs peuplent la nuit et l'installent dans une électricité familière. Ville de ruelles et de chahutes, de lumignons et de fumée où, à cette époque, il n'était pas rare dans ce pays anglophone qu'on aperçut le portrait naïf et stylisé de Patrice Lumumba, assassiné au Congo. La matrone de ce bar, où les intellectuels que nous étions n'étaient pas censés se trouver à 7 heures de la nuit, nous eût volontiers tenu quitte du prix de bière locale que nous consommions, pourvu que nous lui parlions de cet héros déjà légendaire de la terre d'Afrique. Elle nous attribuait en la matière une connaissance qu'elle fondait sur notre pratique du parler français. L'après-midi, nous avions disserté à la moderne université d'Ibadan des héritages linguistiques européens, de la nécessité pour les Africains d'y échapper, de la manière de rapprocher ceux qui en Afrique utilisent la langue française et ceux qui pratiquent l'anglais. La mort d'un tubain faisait plus que tout ce discours. L'énergie populaire était là. Sa puissance accumulée, contenue, vous frappait. Et quand cette masse d'hommes s'exprimera, l'expression sera saisissante. C'est au Nigeria que je pus comprendre ce que signifie d'avoir une terre qui vous porte, vous envahit, vous confond. Là, tout paysage me relevait l'infinie géographie. Il y a de lieux en Grèce ou en Italie, par exemple, où l'on sent, comme lorsqu'on monte au belvédère de Florence, que la nature a réuni là les conditions idéales d'une certaine recherche de la perfection et que l'homme s'y est en réalité parfait. Mais il y a aujourd'hui des lieux où affleure la vocation, la présence, le show du monde entier. Ibadan est de cela, ville sans monuments, mais où la perfection crépite dans la présence du monde. Florence et les hauts lieux grecs peuvent se refermer sur leurs amphithéâtres. Le monde y est secrète et occulte, représentation de soi. La terre immense en Afrique ouvre sur l'Iruée, le monde y est tentation gigantesque de l'autre.
those in the north are right when they refer to the south as the old country. A Negro born in the north who finds himself in the south is in a position similar to that of the son of the Italian emigrant who finds himself in Italy near the village where his father first saw the light of day. Both are in countries they have never seen, but which they cannot fail to recognize. The landscape has always been familiar. The speech is archaic, but it rings a bell, and so do the ways of the people, though their ways are not his ways. Everywhere he turns, the revenant finds himself reflected. He sees himself as he was before he was born, perhaps, or as the man he would have become had he actually been born in this place. He sees the world from an angle odd indeed, in which his fathers awaited his arrival, perhaps in the very house in which he narrowly avoided being born. He sees, in effect, his ancestors who, in everything they do and are, proclaim his inescapable identity. And the northern Negro in the south sees, whatever he or anyone else may wish to believe, that his ancestors are both white and black. The white men, flesh of his flesh, hate him for that very reason. On the other hand, there is scarcely any way for him to join the black community in the South. For both, he and his community are in the grip of the immense illusion that their state is more miserable than his own. This illusion owes everything to the great American illusion that our state is a state to be envied by other people. We are powerful and we are rich. But our power makes us uncomfortable and we handle it very ineptly. The principal effect of our material well-being has been to set the children's teeth on edge. If we ourselves were not so fond of this illusion, we might understand ourselves and other peoples better than we do, and be enabled to help them understand us. I am very often tempted to believe that this illusion is all that is left of the great dream that was to have become America. Whether this is so or not, this illusion certainly prevents us from making America what we say we want it to be. But let us put aside for the moment these subversive speculations. In the fall of last year, my plane hovered over the rust-red earth of Georgia. I was past 30, and I had never seen this land before. I pressed my face against the window, watching the earth come closer. Soon we were just above the tops of trees. I could not suppress the thought that this earth had acquired its color from the blood that had dripped down from these trees. My mind was filled with the image of a black man, younger than I perhaps, or my own age, hanging from a tree while white men watched him and cut his sex from him with a knife. My father must have seen such sights. He was very old when he died, or heard of them, or had this danger touch him. The Negro poet I talked to in Washington, much younger than my father, perhaps 20 years older than myself, remembered such things very vividly, had a long tale to tell, and counseled me to think back on those days. I was to remember that time, whatever else it had failed to do, nevertheless had passed, that the situation, whether or not it was better, certainly no longer was the same. I was to remember that Southern Negroes had endured things I could not imagine. But this did not really place me at such a great disadvantage, since they clearly had been unable to imagine what awaited them in Harlem. I remembered the Scottsboro case, which I had followed as a child. I remembered Angelo Herndon and wondered again whatever had become of him. I remembered the soldier in uniform, blinded by an enraged white man just after the Second World War. There had been many such incidents after the First War, which was one of the reasons I had been born in Harlem. I remembered Will McGee, Emmett Till, and the others. My younger brothers had visited Atlanta some years before. I remembered what they had told me about it. One of my brothers, in uniform, had had his front teeth kicked out by a white officer. I remembered my mother telling us how she had wept and prayed and tried to kiss the venom out of her suicidally embittered son. She managed to do it too. Heaven only knows what she herself was feeling, whose father and brothers had lived and died down there. I remembered myself as a very small boy, already so bitter about the Pledge of Allegiance that I could scarcely bring myself to say it and never, never believed it.
J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule dans leurs souliers, dans leur smoking, dans leur plastron, dans leur faux col, dans leur monocle, dans leur mélan. J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule avec mes oreilles qui ne sont pas faites pour transpirer du matin au soir, qui déshabille avec les maillotages, qui m'affaiblit le membre et enlève à mon corps sa beauté de cache-sexe. J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule avec mon cou en forme de cheminée d'usine, avec ce mot de tête qui cesse chaque fois que je salue quelqu'un. J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule dans leur salon, dans leur manière, dans leur courbette, dans leurs multiples besoins de singerie. J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule avec tout ce qu'ils racontent, jusqu'à ce qu'ils vous servent l'après-midi un peu d'eau chaude et de gâteau enrhumé. J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule avec les théories qu'ils assaisonnent au goût de leurs besoins, de leurs passions, de leur instinct ouvert la nuit en forme de paillasson. J'ai l'impression d'être ridicule parmi eux, souteneurs, parmi eux, égaugeurs, parmi eux, égaugeurs, parmi eux, complices, parmi eux, égaugeurs, parmi eux, souteneurs, parmi eux, complices, les mains, 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 les
Joe and Violet wouldn't think of it. Paying money for a meal they had not missed and that required them to sit still at, or worse, separated by a table? Not now. Not entering the lip of the city, dancing all the way. Her hip bones rubbed his thigh as they stood in the aisle, unable to stop smiling. They weren't even there yet, and already the city was speaking to them. They were dancing, and like a million others, chests pounding, tracks controlling their feet, they stared out of the windows for first sight of the city that danced with them, proving already how much it loved them. Like a million more, they could hardly wait to get there and love it back. Some were slow about it and traveled from Georgia to Illinois, to the city, back to Georgia, out to San Diego, and finally, shaking their heads, surrendered themselves to the city. others knew right away that it was for them this city and no other. They came on a whim because there it was, and why not? They came after much planning, many letters written to and from, to make sure and know how and how much and where. They came for a visit and forgot to go back to tall cotton or short. Discharged with or without honor, fired with or without severance, dispossessed with or without notice, they hung around for a while and then could not imagine themselves anywhere else. Others came because a relative or hometown buddy said, "Man, you best see this place before you die." Or, "We got room now, so pack your suitcase and don't bring no high top shoes." However they came, when or why, the minute the leather of their souls hit the pavement, there was no turning around. Even if the room they rented was smaller than the heifer stall and darker than a morning privy, they stayed to look at their number, hear themselves in an audience, feel themselves moving down the street among hundreds of others who moved the way they did, and who, when they spoke, regardless of the accent, treated language like the same intricate, malleable toy designed for their play. Part of why they loved it was the specter they left behind. The slumped spines of the veterans of the 27th Battalion, betrayed by the commander for whom they had fought like lunatics. The eyes of thousands stupefied with disgust and having been imported by Mr. Armour, Mr. Swift, Mr. Montgomery Ward to break strikes, then dismissed for having done so. The broken shoes of 2,000 Galveston longhorsemen that Mr. Mallory would never pay 50 cents an hour like the white ones. The praying palms, the raspy breathing, the quiet children of the ones who had escaped from Springfield, Ohio, Springfield, Indiana, Greensburg, Indiana, Wilmington, Delaware, New Orleans, Louisiana, after raising wide, had foamed all over the lanes and yards of home. The wave of black people running from want and violence crested in the 1870s, the 80s, the 90s, but was a steady stream in 1906, when Joe and Violet joined it. Like the others, they were country people, but how soon country people forget. When they fall in love with a city, it is forever, and it is like forever. As though there never was a time when they didn't love it. The minute they arrived at the train station or get off the ferry and glimpse the wide streets and the wasteful lamps lighting them, they know they are born for it. There, in a city, they are not so much new as themselves. They're stronger, riskier selves. And in the beginning, when they first arrive, and 20 years later, when they and the city have grown up, they love the part of themselves so much, they forget what loving other people was like. If they ever knew, that is. I don't mean they hate them, no. Just that what they start to love is the way a person is in the city. The way a schoolgirl never pauses by a stoplight, but looks up down the street before stepping off the curb. How men accommodate themselves to tall buildings and wee porches. What a woman looks like moving in a crowd, or how shocking her profile is against the backdrop of the East River. The restfulness in kitchen chores, when she knows the lamp oil or the staple is just around the corner and not 7 miles away. The amazement of throwing open the window and being hypnotized for hours by people on the street below. Little of that makes for love, but it does pump desire. The woman who churned a man's blood as she leaned all alone on a fence by a country road might not expect even to catch his eye in the city. But if she is clipping quickly down the big city street in heels, swinging her purse, or sitting on a stoop with a cool beer in her hand, dangling her shoe from the toes of her foot, the man reacting to her posture, to soft skin on stone, the weight of the building stressing the delicate dangling shoe, is captured. And he'd think it was the woman he wanted, and not some combination of curved stone and a swinging high-heeled shoe moving in and out of sunlight. He would know right away the deception, the trick of shapes and light and movement. But it wouldn't matter at all, because the deception was part of it too. Anyway, he could feel his lungs going in and out. There is no air in the city, but there is breath. And every morning it races through him like laughing gas, brightening his eyes, his talk, and his expectations. In no time at all, he forgets little peppy creeks and apple trees, so old they lay their branches along the ground, and you have to reach down or stoop to pick the fruit. He forgets that the sun that used to slide up like the yolk of a good country egg, thick and red, orange at the bottom of the sky, and he doesn't miss it, doesn't look up to see what happened to it, or stars made irrelevant by the light of thrilling, wasteful street lamps.
Au bout du petit matin, l'extrême trompeuse désolée échare sur la blessure des os. Les martyrs ne témoignent pas, les fleurs du sang qui s'effanent et s'éparpillent dans le vent inutile, comme des cris de perroquet babillard. Une vieille vie monteusement souriante se lève ouverte d'angoisse désaffectée, une misère pourrissant sous le soleil silencieusement, un vieux silence crévant de pustules tièdes. Au bout du petit matin, sur cette plus fragile épaisseur de la terre que dépasse de façon humiliante son grandiose avenir, les volcans éclateront, l'ONU emportera les taches mûres du soleil et il restera plus qu'un bouillonnement tiède picoré d'oiseaux marins. La plage de songe et l'insensé réveil. Au bout du petit matin, cette ville plate, éclatée, trébuchée de son bon sens, inerte et soufflée sous son fardeau géométrique de croix, éternel recommencement, docile à son sort muette, contrarié de toute façon. Au bout du petit matin, les Antilles qui ont faim, les Antilles grêlées de petites véroles, les Antilles dynamitées d'alcool, échouées dans la boue, dans la baie. Au bout du petit matin, dans cette ville inerte, cette foule criante si étonnamment passée à côté de son cri, comme cette ville à côté de son mouvement, de son sens et de son séquitude. Au bout du petit matin, un vrai cri, le seul cri qu'on ait vu. Au bout du petit matin, cette frange foule sans un sens et mélangeant. Au bout du petit matin, la ville à découvrir. Au bout du petit matin, le fleuve qui s'esquive. Au bout du petit matin, la ville inerte, cette foule désolée. Au bout du petit matin, cette foule désolée sous le soleil. Au bout du petit matin, cette ville dévolée sous le soleil. Au bout du petit matin, 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 la ville morne oubliée de son thème. Au bout du petit matin, le bord de sa peau inquiète. Au bout du petit matin, le sang est paludé, mais en déroute le soleil de poubelle. Au bout du petit matin, le ciel range la voiture de bord. Au bout du petit matin, au bout du petit matin.
They speak of taxes, of oil and power. They speak of honor and pride of tribe. They speak of war, of bows and arrows. They speak of tanks and putrid human flesh. I sing my love for Maria.